Hello everyone, and welcome to this part three of my Doctor Who DVD collection, where we're going to be going through the John Pertwee era, the fantastic John Pertwee, the suave, sophisticated, debonair, James Bond-like dandy. That is fantastic John Pertwee. One of my favourite Doctors. It's a close call between him and Tom Baker, who I prefer. Probably at the end of my Tom Baker marathon, I'll probably make a more conclusive decision, but absolutely love John Pertwee. He was a fantastic actor. Those who have seen his other work will know what a charismatic and what a versatile actor he was, much like Patrick Troughton. And his run through his time with Doctor Who, in my opinion, is probably the most consistently brilliant run out of all the Doctors, even including Patrick Troughton, who I think probably had also the most consistent run, but due to the fact that obviously Patrick Troughton's stories, a lot of them are missing, so because of all of Pertwee's stories surviving, we get much more of a better overview of how great his era was. So without further ado, let's get started. So let's get started with our complete John Pertwee era, starting with what is, for me, the best season of Doctor Who that I've seen. That's season 7. It's very adult. The writing, John Pertwee, his companion Liz, who I think is a really underestimated companion, who was brilliant in season 7. The whole thing in this season is absolutely fantastic. It's a really strong season, and we kick it off with this, the four-parter Spearhead from Space, and this is a 10 out of 10 straight away. There is Liz, the companion. She's really great, intelligent, and of course these are earthbound stories predominantly, as after the Troughton era ended, he gets banished by the Time Lords to Earth, where he cannot travel. Of course, John Pertwee tries to fix the TARDIS throughout most of his run to try and get the TARDIS to go back to other planets in the galaxy. And as we see here, Lethbridge Stewart, Brigadier Lethbridge Stewart, becomes a regular as part of the Earth Army Secret Agency unit. So yeah, Spearhead from Space, the first story to feature the Autons, really creepy and really menacing. It's just an absolutely fantastic story, great four-parter. The introduction of John Pertwee is great, one of the best opening stories for a new Doctor. And it's just fantastic. It's absolutely brilliant, quite dark, and the season 7 stories are very mature and targeted at adults as well as children, and it's much more obvious here. So yeah, Spearhead from Space, fantastic start, 10 out of 10, and another 10 out of 10, and for me, this is one of the most underestimated Doctor Who stories of all time, Doctor Who and the Silurians. This is fantastic, 7-part story, and you know, this is really overlooked. Some people think it drags. I really don't think it does. I think it's perfectly spread out, much like the War Games and the Invasion. It goes by so quickly. The story is really good. The monster is really menacing, and the Silurians are really interesting. The conflict of interests and how they start out being quite peace-loving and misunderstood to then becoming quite menacing, and how the Doctor just tries to keep peace between the humans and the Silurians, and it all going badly wrong, and there's an epidemic and all the rest of it. It's just a fantastic story. It's probably my favourite, at least my joint favourite from season 7, which is fantastic, like I've said already about 100 times, so 10 out of 10 for that. And The Ambassadors of Death, another underestimated story in my opinion. I give this a 9.5 out of 10. Just because there are a couple of repetitive moments in this story, but other than that, again, this is a really fantastic story, kind of like a crime thriller. It's really interesting, and I really love this story as well. Maybe on another viewing I might give it a 10 out of 10, but again, Ambassadors of Death, fantastic story. And we get, automatically, this is going to get a 10 out of 10. This is the fantastic Inferno. absolutely sensational story with a twist involving, I won't give too much away if you haven't seen it, but if you're a Doctor Who fan, you've surely seen this story. And if not, pick it up straight away. The sort of parallel universes going on during this absolute catastrophe that's undertaken in this massive industrial factory. That twist wasn't expecting. The story as it was going along, I thought it was brilliant as it was, and then with that sort of parallel universe twist, absolutely spectacular. John Pertwee is amazing. Lethbridge Stewart there with the eye patch, won't give away why he's wearing the eye patch, but yeah, 10 out of 10. And this concludes the fantastic season 7, the best season of Doctor Who, the most mature in terms of its content. Absolutely fantastic, and absolutely brilliant. And next, to kick off season 8, we have another Auton story, which is Terror of the Autons, which introduces my favourite female companion, Katie Manning. Katie Manning, along with Jamie, are probably my two favourite companions. She was absolutely fantastic. So obviously, at the end of Inferno, we saw the last of Liz, who I thought was a pretty good companion, underrated, like I said. And then we got Katie Manning as Jo Grant, who is brilliant, and of course Roger Delgado as the Master in this first Master story, and he is absolutely fantastic in this. And Terror of the Autons is just absolutely brilliant, brilliant, brilliant story. And some people are a little bit critical of the ending, but I personally couldn't see it ending any other way than the way it did. Absolutely underrated classic for me here, The Mind of Evil. 10 out of 10 this gets for me. I love this story. The whole being set in a prison environment, the whole thing about a manipulative mind machine with involving the Master as well. 10 out of 10 this gets. And the Master, for me, this is his best story. Absolutely fantastic. And to be honest, this has a place in season 7. This story would have really fitted very well with that sort of darker, more adult theme that runs through season 7. Yeah, The Mind of Evil is absolutely brilliant. I think it's very underrated. The Claws of Axos, yeah, it's a four-parter, pretty good story, quite eerie. Some of the execution is a little bit iffy. But like with all the stories during the Pertwee era, if Pertwee, it just gives it everything in every story, and that alone, you know, there's not an average story through the Pertwee era, purely because they're fantastic stories anyway. But his performances are always top notch, and Roger Delgado as the Master is absolutely fantastic. But this is a really good story. Like to see the Axonites or whatever, I've forgotten what they're called, Axons or whatever. I'd like to see them return. So 8 out of 10 for Claws of Axos, and another 8 out of 10 for this. Underrated again, this one, Colony in Space. Again, some people criticise this one because they believe it drags a little bit and it takes a while for the Master to appear in this story. Personally, I like that. When you've had three consecutive stories centred around the Master, I think that this is really good. I like that it takes a while for the Master to appear. It gets the story going between the colonists and the miners and the corruption and all the rest of it, and the monsters and the sort of thriller-based side of it. Pertwee is really great again. And then when the Master does appear, it all sort of turns around, and then you sort of, it starts to make even more sense to the mystery behind what's going on in this with the colonists and everything else. Colony in Space, 8 out of 10. I think this one is underrated. And then we have, for me, an overrated story, The Daemons, or The Demons, or The Daemons, however you pronounce it. I'll say Daemons. It's a really good story. I give it a 7 out of 10, but I personally think it's slightly overrated. Yes, it's a sort of horror-based story, and it's, again, obviously another Earth story, but the White Witch in this story gets on my nerves a little bit. It's maybe that was how the character was meant to come across, but she kind of irritates me. The Master is again pretty good, but a lot of the story is sort of centered around the Master, going through these satanic rituals, posing as a priest, and you don't actually really get to see the demon very much until right at the end. And for me, that kind of was a little bit disappointing, I guess. But the story is still great, a great story. Execution was it was pretty good. But yeah, I wouldn't consider this an absolute classic, for me anyway. Maybe rewatching it, I might think differently again, might appreciate it more a second or third time watching it. Maybe it's because also Katie Manning and John Pertwee really liked this story. It was one of their personal favourites that it gets such a good sort of outstanding review and stuff. But yeah, it's still a great story. But yeah, I give that a 7 out of 10. And then we come to season 9 with Day of the Daleks. I don't know if this has mixed views, but personally, again, I think this is a bit... This is a good story again. I give it a 7 out of 10. Some people really praise it. Some people even say that it's the best Pertwee Dalek story, which I wouldn't agree with personally. But yeah, it gets a 7 out of 10. I just think that when it's called Day of the Daleks, I expect to have more action involving the Daleks. And the battle at the end with the Daleks just... From the original cut, I think was a little bit underwhelming. It's a very good story, very interesting story, and I do appreciate the story. But in terms of the execution, yeah, it's for me not the greatest Pertwee story, but still miles better than a lot of later Doctor Who stories in the later years. Curse of Peladon. Now this one, again, there's a lot of people that don't really like the Peladon stories. I personally really enjoyed it. I gave this a 8 out of 10. Of course, the King of Peladon is played by Michael Troughton, which of course is Patrick Troughton's son. I can't see on the back. I think it's Michael Troughton. Can't remember. Or David. Never mind. Move on. So yeah, Curse of Peladon. I really like the story. There's a nice little fight sequence with the Doctor, and the Ice Warriors are for me the highlight of this story. Now the reason I like it so much with the Ice Warriors is because they are, you know, I find them really menacing in this story and really intense, even though they're being very passive and very obliging and actually not causing any conflict or any kind of trouble in Peladon at all. But it's always that sort of intense fear that they're going to become, you know, what's the best word to describe it? Hostile at any point. Even towards the end of the story, I'm waiting for them to become hostile, but they never do. But it's just that intensity behind it. I really like that about the Peladon story. But it is a really excellent story. Yeah, it's great. I give it an 8 out of 10. I like the Peladon stories. Shoot me. And then we have another classic, The Sea Devils. I give this a 9 out of 10. When I finished watching it, I wasn't sure about it, but when I watched it again and thought about it afterwards as well, I really loved it. I give it a 9 out of 10. Yeah, Curse of Peladon, I gave it an 8 out of 10. Yeah, The Sea Devils, 9 out of 10. The Master, really good. It has that sort of Doctor Who and the Silurians feeling, that sort of creepy, dark feeling, that claustrophobic feeling, especially the bit on the ship. That's a really great scene as well. And the fight scene between the Doctor and the Master. The Master, again, is absolutely fantastic in this story. Yeah, Sea Devils, yeah, fantastic story. 9 out of 10. Probably, definitely, actually the best from season 9. Then we have The Mutants. A lot of people's least favourite story from the John Pertwee era. Yes, the execution in this story is awful. The special effects is pretty abysmal in places, and not good at all. But the story, I think, is pretty good. There's a cliffhanger in this story that is quite embarrassing to look at. It is embarrassing. But these monsters here, the mutants, they're actually quite good. But it's just the sort of scenery and the special effects and stuff like that, and the executions in some of this story is absolutely abysmal. But Yeah, I really, really like The Mutants. Well, I don't really, really like it. I don't praise it as such. But yeah, I think it's a good story. I give that a 7 out of 10. And then we have another one that a lot of people consider their least favourite John Pertwee Doctor Who story, The Time Monster, featuring Tom Tit. If you've seen it, you'll get that reference. Do I think it's a load of Tom Tit? It's not the best. I would probably say one of my least favourite from the Pertwee era, but still good. I still give it 7 out of 10. It's just when they go to Atlantis at the end, that's when I sort of start to think that it went downhill. I probably would have given it a 7.5 perhaps, but the last section of this story where they go to Atlantis, yeah, kind of killed it off a little bit. And this is a good story. Good, not the best way to end season 9, but it's still a good story. Like I said, there's no bad stories during the John Pertwee era. And then we kick off season 10 with The Three Doctors, the 10th anniversary, and it features my two of my favourite doctors, Patrick Troughton and John Pertwee, but also features the very first doctor, William Hartnell. It's a special story for me. A four-parter, one of my favourite four-parters. This gets a 10 out of 10 for me. Yes, it might not be the most amazing story ever, but it's beautifully executed. I think it's Bob Baker and Dave Martin, who don't always do the best stories in the world when it comes to the classic Who, but this one is well written. The enemy is really menacing, very well portrayed, and Troughton and Pertwee, the way they bounce off each other is absolutely superb. Yeah, this is absolutely brilliant. I love The Three Doctors. 10 out of 10 for me. And then we get an underrated story, Carnival of Monsters, which I think is getting much more of an iconic status because the monster is quite iconic now. When you see Doctor Who conventions or Doctor Who sites or merchandise, you always see the head of the monster from the Carnival of Monsters. It's a very interesting kind of deja vu, slash sci-fi, slash mystery, slash whatever. It's quite an interesting story. I think it's by Robert Holmes. Yeah, it's Robert Holmes, who does do great stories. But yeah, it's not the greatest story. It's a nice little four-parter, and I give it a 7.5 out of 10. And then we have a story that I really wasn't expecting much from, but The Frontier in Space is a fantastic story. 9 out of 10. Sadly, it's the last time we see Roger Delgado as the Master, as he tragically was killed in a car crash not long after this was produced. It's a great little story. I give it a 9 out of 10. The only thing that sort of holds it back from being a 9.5 or a 10 out of 10 is the ending. They had an original ending shot that was cut. So the Master's exit, if you've seen it, is a little bit abrupt, but it's still ended with an alternative ending involving the Doctor, which is probably a better ending. I've never seen the original, and I'm sure we won't get to see the original ending, but I don't know, unless it's in the special features, but skip past that. Let me know in the comments if there is any footage of that, or if it is in the special features, because I haven't had a chance to go through the special features. Anyway, let's move on. So that ending is really good, and it leads straight into this, which is Planet of the Daleks. And what I love about this is it kind of feels like a 12-part story rather than two separate 6-part stories, because they lead into each other. And yeah, I thought I was going to drop there. Planet of the Daleks, I give this an 8 out of 10. It's kind of a 10th anniversary celebration of the original Dalek story with William Hartnell, and there are sort of recycled elements from the original Dalek stories with William Hartnell that are recreated in this, but it's still a really good story anyway, and really, really enjoyable. And yeah, I really like Planet of the Daleks. I give that an 8 out of 10. And I give this a 10 out of 10. The Green Death, Joe Grant's departure, really emotional ending when she has to say goodbye to the Doctor. And the Doctor riding off in the sunset is just a beautiful ending. But the whole story is fantastic. It, again, it feels a little bit like Doctor Who and the Silurians or the Sea Devils. It's got that creepy, dark edge to it. But it's also quite fun, and it's really good. And these monsters here are pretty creepy. There's, again, some iffy execution, but it doesn't distract from the fact that it's a really fantastic story. Yeah, so The Green Death, absolutely brilliant. Brilliant end to season 10. Brilliant companion exit, my favourite companion exit of my favourite companion. And, yeah, very, very good. And then we kick off season 11, John Pertwee's final season, with a great story, The Time Warrior. I give this an 8 out of 10. I can see that this is a story that will probably go up in my estimation the more I see it, but yeah, The Time Monster is pretty good. 8 out of 10, nice little historical setting, and of course it's the introduction of many people's favourite companion, Sarah Jane Smith. Not my personal favourite companion. I like her, but there's something, I feel sometimes a little bit detached from her. When I watch her, I don't warm to her quite as much as I warm to some of the other companions, but she is one of the better actors to come out of Doctor Who, and she is finding her way here. She's not as evolved as she is in the later stories, especially during the Tom Baker era. I don't think her and John Pertwee had as good a rapport together as she did with Tom Baker. And then we have an underrated one, Invasion of the Dinosaurs. 8 out of 10 for me. The story is really fantastic, and the opening episode where they enter London and it's like a ghost town, and then this pterodactyl thing comes attacking at the Doctor and attacks Sarah Jane, I think that's really good. Quite creepy. But yes, the dinosaurs overall, the design, the special effects are absolutely abysmal. But what I have to say, though, is it is a great story. So just ignore that. Accept that it is what it is. But watch it for the story, because it is brilliant. And the first episode is shown in black and white, but you can have the option to watch it in its reconstructed colour version. So, yeah, that's how I watch it anyway, because all these have been either recoloured or they are available in colour. And also, that's one of the things about the Pertwee era over the Troughton era, is we have, this is the first season, this is the first Doctor, sorry, where we have every single story that he did, whereas with, obviously, sadly, with Hartnell and Troughton, not every story is available to us on DVD. So, you know, it's much clearer to see what a fantastic era John Pertwee had. And next we have Death to the Daleks. It's a fun little run-around story, Dalek story. I quite enjoyed it. It's got a good little twist, the whole idea of the Daleks not being able to use their powers and all the rest of it. This kind of reminds me a little bit of The Chase. It's a bit of a silly run-around Dalek story. It's definitely got good as Planet of the Daleks. But I would say I probably enjoy this slightly more than I do Day of the Daleks. And I think I gave this a 7.5. I gave it a 7 out of 10. And then we have The Monster of Peladon. Do I prefer Monster of Peladon to Curse? I've given it an 8 out of 10. And just like the Ice Warriors and the Seeds of Death, there are elements about one that I like more than the other, and vice versa. I really like the leader of the Ice Warriors. Can never remember his name, but he's really good. He's fantastic in this. The Ice Warriors are brilliant because they're back to being menacing it's a different sort of intensity with Monster of Peladon than there is Curse. More seems to be going on in Monster, and in that way it's better. But as a story, I probably would say I prefer Curse slightly. But they're both just as good for different reasons. So yeah, I give this Monster of Peladon, I give this an 8 out of 10. And sadly, that was the penultimate story, and now we come to the final John Pertwee story, Planet of the Spiders. Is it a good exit for fantastic Third Doctor? It's a good, very, it's a great ending. Episode 2, which is basically a sort of James Bond style chase, I think is actually really good. I really enjoyed that. It was one of my favourite episodes from this story. It's a fitting end. It kind of encapsulates what John Pertwee was all about. It kind of reverts back to an earlier story, if you get the reference with the blue gem there. And yeah, it's good. It's a good story. It's a great story. I gave it 8 out of 10. Very sad to see John Pertwee go after 24 stories, but it was a good exit. And his final scene is very emotive as well, just like Joe Grant's, and it's very well executed. So yeah, fantastic. So the John Pertwee era for me gets a 9 out of 10, just the same as Patrick Troughton does. Not a bad story in all these stories along here, but I just think it's a fantastic era. Season 7 being the absolute highlight, but there are so many gems. And like I said, even the good stories, John Pertwee is just fantastic in all of them. And yeah, it's absolutely brilliant. Like I said, his era, I give a 9 out of 10. And of course, next up will be the fantastic Tom Baker. And as you can see, these are stories straight out of one of the better seasons. Ignore that. Out of one of the better seasons, which is season 12, his first season. So yeah, part 4 will be about Tom Baker and his era and his stories and my reviews and overviews and everything. So don't forget, like, subscribe, share and comment, and I will see you folks on the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye bye.